I'm Tom Zalatni.
And I'm Tefer Ajemian.
And we're the hosts of the No Bad Food podcast.
No Bad Food is a show about great food and the people who love to make and eat it. Our mandate is simple: to explore, taste, and learn about food in ways that celebrate all the things that make it great.
Every week we dig into a different dish, meal, ingredient, cuisine, or piece of food media, exploring the history and culture around it, sharing favorite recipes, and learning from our wonderful guests.
The only rule?
You gotta love it.
After all, there's no such thing as bad food.
Find us in the Pod Cavern or wherever fine podcasts are sold.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sam.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Tom.
And this is
Dummies.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another. Would we call this an event episode?
I would.
I think it has.
I would on multiple levels.
The whole family's here to celebrate.
Yeah, I think we're heading to Colombia in a magical Encanto.
What if people didn't know what Disney Dummies was about to tell everyone
what the show is about. Thank you, Tongue. But I thought they should know, you know, if you don't want to hear us talk about an Encanto, then don't listen to the show.
They shouldn't have clicked on the episode.
But Tongue's right, everybody. This is Disney Dummies, if you didn't know. And it's our 60th episode.
Whoa.
That's insane.
Which you guys are old.
We're old, and it means that we're caught up.
As of this recording, we are caught up. I mean, by the time this episode releases, I think the next one would have come out. But right now,
yeah,
big moment.
Mm-hmm. Which we'll obviously be going to see, so we'll get there. But yeah, as of this moment, we are caught up. We have watched every Disney theatrical release. I have drawn fan art for every theatrical release.
I've edited every single one of our discussions.
And I've painstakingly written
a paragraph,
extremely detailed episode descriptions.
And, you know, we've all come on this journey of this podcast. So, I mean, listeners.
Emotional, yeah, honestly. I'll be honest with you. It's a big moment today in the Pod Cavern on Disney Dummies.
It is a big moment. And listeners at home, maybe you know this, maybe you don't. But like I said, this is the 60th episode. And we started this in the pandemic, very shortly when it started, right?
Yep.
And now we're finishing it. And it feels like,
wow,
like almost like a blink of an eye. And we've watched 60 movies.
You know what's crazy? The other thing is like, and sorry for the noise in the background, because Captain Meatball is furiously.
You got a dog around episode 25 or so. Yeah,
he is scratching at the carpet. So that's what you're hearing. I forget what I was trying to say. I think it's just insane to think that we've done this for this long, and most of it has still been the pandemic. Even right now on episode 60,
let's be honest, when people are listening to this episode 3 years from now, we will still be in a pandemic.
I think that's what it is.
Not saying we're out, but it's just weird how times worked, and how, like you said, you got a dog around episode 25, you got married episode 50, I got a dog around So this show has just kind of like been a steady constant for
you
us, I feel like, through this
too?
Whole time.
What's interesting is that a lot of our audience has also gone through that journey. I know a lot of people who listen to Disney Dummies on different wavelengths and different episodes and stuff, but they've also have gone through crazy stuff over the last 2 years. So it's really cool to see
some of them are old enough to listen to the Who Fuck segment now.
Well, that's true. segment's been around since episode one.
Since the start of this show, we've all gone to Disneyland and got COVID.
Yeah. Disney World, thank you very much.
Disney World. We'll get to that episode later.
Disney World.
Yeah, that's a teaser for the next episode because
juicy.
But anyways, Sam, back to you.
Wow, spoilers. Yeah. Okay, so as I already spoiled, I guess, right away, is, yeah, we're going to Encanto, which is, I think, in Colombia-esque. It's supposed to be Colombia. So there's that's
song,
where we're going.
The song at the end says Colombia, so I think it's safe for us for it to, we can call it canon.
Yeah,
it from all is. I have read, it is Colombia. So, yeah, but I mean, to take us away more into the world of Encanto, I'm going to throw it over to Laura.
No nostalgia from last time we watched.
You're right. It's been a hot
even
minute.
Though it's been like less than a year. So
it's
this
true.
Movie
it feels weird. It does feel weird sitting down on the couch to watch this. I mean, I'm just going to start with that then myself, but it feels weird sitting down on the couch to watch this because, yeah, it did just come out in the past year. So nostalgia for us all is probably going to be quite similar.
But you know what's interesting? I think this movie was, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm quite sure this was still part of the Disney Premier Access catalog thing because it was a Disney movie and you still had to pay to rent slash own it. They did also put it in theaters as well, but it was like towards the tail end of them doing that thing.
Did we see it?
We saw it here at home on the TV, which means...
On the TV?
Yeah, on the TV. We didn't go to a theater to watch it. Mm-hmm. So we must have...
But it released... really fast though because I didn't pay the premier access for it, but I watched it on Disney Plus and then it was like
happened to us too. I don't even know,
it was still in theaters when we like watched it, like and I think it was doing bad in theaters. Nobody was going. This is the vibe I kind of got, was that it wasn't doing very well in theaters. They took it off premier access, they just threw it on Disney Plus, but then on Disney Plus it blew up because everyone was like, oh shit, this movie's actually good. And then they like re-released it to theaters or extended the theater time because they were like, okay, well, if you really like it, like you can still go to the theater and see it.
I also think, like, well, we'll talk about it, but the song of the movie, the song that kind of like destroyed the world for multiple weeks on end, and people were like, yeah, we should watch this movie. So
I got the inside track. So it was released on November 24th. In my phone, I have a note called Encanto that was labeled January, that was written on January 24th. So we watched it 2 months after it came out.
Oh,
we waited a while.
Wow, we waited. And the funny thing with this movie, I think we all have the same nostalgia because it wasn't very long ago. But the funny thing was that Sam messages us that she's watching Encanto, but it was still one of those things where, like, I guess we're not going to talk about it for like a year.
Yeah, we would have been doing Dummies, but like, I couldn't talk about it.
I couldn't talk about it with Laura.
So many, there's probably
this is the first time we get to talk about it.
There's probably a Dummies episode where we mention that we just watched Encanto, but can't talk about it.
Yeah,
probably.
I haven't talked about it with Laura for
we
over
don't
a
talk
year.
About Encanto.
That's for like a we year, don't yeah. talk about Encanto. It's so funny. Yeah, and I mean, just one more thing on my nostalgia is I remember I got, because I didn't really, I mean, in nostalgia, sometimes we talk about how, like, hyped or whatever we were for it, and, like, I remember, like, not, because we were coming off Raya, which I hadn't seen, and I just feel like I hadn't been, like, as excited lately or, like, watching them as much, so I hadn't seen Raya yet, and then Encanto kind of came, and I was, like, not really that jazzed about it or anything, and this was before I learned of our Lord and Savior, Lin-Manuel, so I was, like, also just, like...
Manuel.
Miranda. So I just really... I didn't really care that much, so when it came on Disney Plus, I was like, oh, okay, I'll watch this now. And it was, like, the day after I got my, like, second COVID shot, so I was just, like, conked on the couch all day, and I was like, well, I'll throw on this movie to watch, I guess. And then I watched it, and I'll
and then
save
you watched
the rest
it. We
of my
don't
thoughts.
Know about save the rest.
It. Save it.
I think save I think it. I was in a similar boat, Sam. I did watch Raya, but I was starting to feel the Disney fatigue, the same way I was starting to feel, like, the Marvel fatigue, just like... Oh man, they all we talked about this many times. How all the character like they all look the same. Like animation isn't that exciting anymore. And Encanto, from a snippet, because I didn't actually watch any trailers for Encanto before watching it, I was like, oh, it looks exactly like those other movies. Blah blah blah. But
yeah, agreed.
I guess we'll talk about it.
I just mentioned that there's a note in my phone that I created on January 24th. That's called Encanto. Let's just say there's a section of that note called Hot Takes.
Hot takes, all right.
Wow.
Oh, okay.
From a year
save
ago.
I'll save it.
Okay. Well, we should just get into it.
Yeah. Laura, take us away.
Okay. Encanto. We open on Abuela telling young Mirabelle the story of their family's magic. As the story goes, well, it's not as the story goes, like this is what happened. Abuela and Abuelo Pedro were escaping grave danger and he was killed. But then a candle appeared and the candle gave the family magic. And the magic became a house, and the house was alive.
There's no way you can keep it up like this the entire summer.
No, no. This is just the family history. This is just the family history. I'm trying to establish a
tone. I know.
Wait, was it Abuelo?
Abuelo, you said? Abuelo Pedro was killed.
What?
Right now, it's like, too early.
Oh, it's too early. Pedro.
Is it? I thought it's just when they appear. Yeah. Okay, I'll wait, I guess. I mean, but Abuelo Fox.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Sorry.
I think this alarm will sound a few times, to be honest with you.
Yeah, well, you know what? For this episode, since it's so special, just alarm it anytime someone fucks.
You're right. Yeah. It is special. That's we should do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've gone this far during this segment. We might as well go all the way.
Okay, can you guys give me a second while I reestablish tone?
Yeah.
As their three children came of age, each was blessed with a magical gift. We'll learn those later. Mirabelle reaches for the, and then we flash to the day that Mirabelle is supposed to get her gift by opening the door that has her name on it. And as she reaches for the door to get her gift, we see the title card, Encanto, and we're in the present. So we've got our main character, Mirabelle, or as I like to call her, Mirabelle. And the neighborhood kids are asking Mirabelle about the family's gifts. So rather than telling them what they are, she sings them. We've got Felix. No, he's the uncle. He doesn't have a gift. Peppa, Aunt Tia. Tia Peppa.
You're not going to sing them all to us?
Yeah, I would love to. Let's just say Peppa handles the weather. There's Bruno, but
we don't talk about Bruno.
Julieta, who is her mother, and her mother, Mirabelle's mother, makes food that heals people. There's Mirabelle's sister, Luisa, who is extremely strong.
Okay, I was going to wee-wee with the mother.
But a lot of the family of Madrigal definitely fucks.
I would say, can we just wee-woo the whole family?
Yeah, is there anyone in the family who doesn't?
I mean, like... Probably like the children.
Carmelo and Antonio. Let me introduce them. Carmelo is actually, I think Carmelo is older than Mirabelle, even though he looks younger because he got the door first.
Yeah, Laura made that point yesterday, and I was like, that actually makes sense, which that's insane because he looks younger than Mirabelle.
Oh, yeah, I had not considered that.
But I mean, that's assuming that each family member gets
their gifts. They're probably super close, though. I bet they're like a year apart or something. Yeah.
It could also be that, like, they're given their gifts at random times, like, the door just starts to glow at random intervals. Like, it's not necessarily all of the
same. That was an age thing, right? It wasn't.
They never say
They don't say if it's like your birthday everything. Or what.
We don't. Like... This is strange magic.
It's an Encanto. We don't know. Strange Encanto. Yeah.
So, anyways, Carmelo is a shapeshifter. Careful. He could do much more nefarious things than he does in this movie by being a shapeshifter. I'll just tell you that. And then there's young Antonio, and we'll talk about him later. But anyways, I think it's probably safe to say that Carmelo and Antonio, we can leave out of this category.
Sure.
But the rest, for sure.
Fuck.
Yeah.
Okay.
Probably not Mirabelle's dad.
Oh, I was going to say Mirabelle's dad.
You really? Think so?
Fuck?
Yeah.
I don't think so either.
I think her uncle does. I think Felix does.
Which one's Felix?
Felix is the uncle.
The Peppa's husband?
The one who like does a lot of booty shaking when he's doing salsa with Peppa.
Okay, yeah. The husband. Yeah. He's exactly. Yeah.
So we've
Mirabelle's dad bugs. He's so nice. He gives her a pep talk. He's like all into his wife and
he's
I don't
Danny
know.
Danny Tanner, Sam. Danny Tanner doesn't fuck.
Who's Danny Tanner?
From Full House.
Oh, I don't know.
The dad from Full House. Anyways.
It doesn't register that he fucks for me, but
Uncle Jesse does.
Maybe we talk about the song?
Well, I'm not even done introducing everyone yet. Okay. So we've got her parents, Julieta and dad, and then we've got her aunt and uncle, Peppa and Felix, and then we have her cousins. Oh, of course, there's also Dolores. Dolores can hear a pin drop. What is it? What do they say in the lyrics about Dolores? Yeah, it's literally Dolores can hear a pin drop. So she's Carmelo and Antonio's sister. And then we already met Luisa, but then there's Isabella.
Isabella.
And she, like, her gift is that she's the perfect golden girl. She's very graceful, but really her, like, magic gift is that she can make flowers.
Flowers in, like, plant life, I would say, because she makes cactus.
Pretty amazing. Cacti later. Oh, and I didn't mention that Pippa's emotions control the weather.
Yeah, that's right.
So she can't always control her emotions. I think we can all identify with that, but that's her thing. So anyways, this is a great song. It's called The Family Madrigal.
Let's talk about it. I remember when we first watched it, Laura, because I do remember actually that it was in the basement. It was like wintertime and it was like by like a cozy fire and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And when we watched this song for the first time, it was the first song that popped up in Encanto too. And I had mm-hmm. big expectations because it was Lin-Manuel Miranda. I'm sure we're going to be praising his in the entirety of Encanto. I will say the first time I watched it, I wasn't as impressed because maybe I was just having a hard time hearing what was mm-hmm. being said, but I was having a hard time like understanding her explaining the Family of Madrigal because it was mm-hmm. so fast. But this time around we had subtitles on and honestly, it does a world of difference. No, because like Lin-Manuel Miranda, let's be honest, he's like a freak when it comes to lyric. Like any lyric that he has is so meticulously crafted to rhyme with a certain thing and also have like a double meaning, a triple meaning. Like there's just so much meat in his lyrics. Yeah. And with a song of Family of Madrigal, they go through all the exposition in this song of like who the family is to get you set up. And then seeing the lyrics as it's happening, I think really helped me understand what was happening mm-hmm. and really elevated the song.
I don't think the song's that great. It's fun.
Yeah,
it's, I don't think it's. Like, I don't think it's.
Yeah, that's my vibe. Was the first time I also struggled to just like figure out what the fuck was going on, and the song wasn't like it because it's so fast too. I'm like, it's
so fast.
It's so fast. I couldn't remember any of it. All I remember is the Family Madrigal, and then I don't remember like anything Madrigal. In between.
Listen, it's no Alexander Hamilton. It's no In the Heights. It's fine.
I 100% agree, but. Once you see those lyrics as she's saying it, it's very impressive how she's doing it. But yes, of course, as you're listening to it, it's impossible to know what she's saying.
Even with visuals and everything, it's a lot. And the second time, I definitely appreciated it more because I knew who she was talking about and I could follow it a little better.
Yeah.
But even then, I don't think the song is like the strong. Well, it's definitely not the strongest in the movie.
It's not
at
the
all,
strongest, but it still gets in your head. I think we can all think about what has to happen.
Skillful. We'll call it skillful.
Yeah. And I think
but not as enjoyable.
Yeah. And it does what it sets out to do as well. Like I know I was reading and just that the movie does have a big cast, which I think was a worry when they were developing it. They're like, oh my god, like we have too many characters. And I think it was Lynn who's like, I'll just explain them all in this song in the beginning. Yeah. And
it's fine.
Yeah, it's fine.
We'll cover it.
So
now that we know the family and all their gifts, we watch the family using those gifts to prepare for Antonio's gift ceremony. So he's the youngest cousin. His door is starting to glow. He's about to get his family gift. Hopefully, fingers crossed, because as has been alluded to, Mirabel didn't get a gift when it was her time for the gift ceremony. So Antonio's hiding and Mirabel finds him under the bed in the nursery and he confesses to her that he's worried that it's not going to work. But Mirabel, being the great big cousin that she is, she makes him feel better about it and she kind of coaxes him out.
And everyone in the town is a really big dick about it too, about Mirabel not having a
it's like,
they're not subtle.
Weird setup where it's like you have this how do you say it? Like a matriarchal family setup where everyone in this casita is like completely powerful or at least married into the family. And then everyone else in the town kind of, I don't know, they like bow down to this like higher power, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like they really worship the Madrigals.
Yeah, I found it really like hard to watch the first, not hard to watch, but I found it really depressing the first time because the whole time, like, Mirabelle is this ray of sunshine and she's actually like so cute and like clearly doesn't care about not having a power. She clearly loves her family so much right at the beginning. And everyone's just like pushing her to care about this thing that she doesn't. And I'm like, man, everyone just like shut the fuck up. Like the whole town's like, aren't you like sad that you don't have one? Oh, today must be really hard on you because you don't have a power. Like you don't have a gift. And they just like are driving that home to her so much. And I was like, oh my God, like let her, like, she's happy. Just let her be.
That's
happy.
Why Mirabelle fucks, honestly.
Yeah. Oh, Mirabelle. Yeah.
Great.
She doesn't
character.
Take shit from nobody.
She's such a good character. She is one of my favorite protagonists in a while. Like, she's awesome.
I wrote, people are arriving for candy, but I'm pretty sure that's supposed to say ceremony. I must have been thinking about candy. And the house is doing some magical shit. And then we see the door starts to glow. For Antonio.
No.
Am I rapping?
By the way, the house, Casita.
Casita.
Wee-oo. Tell me I'm wrong. Tell me I'm wrong.
No, you're right.
No.
House fucks.
Not today.
House definitely fucks.
And as Antonio's door starts to glow, we get a flashback to Mirabelle's ceremony when the door disappeared. But back in the present, Antonio reaches for the handle, the door lights up, and a bird lands on his arm. And we discover that Antonio can now talk to animals.
I think like a huge, big emotional part of this whole scene is that Antonio asked for Mirabelle's hand. And I was like, Sam might be crying here. I'm not sure. Like when
No, you didn't say Sam might be crying. You said, Sam's crying.
Yes, I did say that. Did you cry during that? Like, it's such a cute moment.
I didn't cry at that part. No.
You know the moment, though, where he reaches his hand up to her behind the curtain?
Oh, of course, I do. Because it was like one more, where I think it's a very cute moment and it's very understandable that he wants her because, like, they clearly have a bond and a relationship. Yeah. So it makes a lot of sense for him to want her to walk down the aisle. That sounds weird.
Up
the stairs with him. It makes so much sense. She obviously would be happy to do it, but then everyone's so weird about it. And I'm like, guys, be cool.
Everyone's weird about it, but that's why Mirabelle's awesome. And she's like, I'm going
to
do it anyways because she cares
There's
so
no
much.
There's no rules to the ceremony. There's no rules. We can do what we want.
He wants my help. I'm going to help him. Like, everyone back the fuck
who's gonna
off.
Tell him they're wrong? The magic candle.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
I love it. And even Abuela, you can see her look being like, not Mirabelle.
Yeah.
But Mirabelle does it anyway.
She's a real piece of work that wait, hang on a second. Abuela, does she fuck?
Abuela?
No.
Probably.
Samson's is so bitter right now.
Probably not. Maybe at the end of the movie, but
I don't know.
Probably barely. Not. Slow fucker.
Anyways, Antonio can talk to animals and he enters his new room, which is like this amazing jungle space. A jungle cat. I'm not going to try and figure out what kind of cat that is. We know what kind of wormhole that will go down if we start figuring out what cat that is. Picks up Antonio, throws it on their back and just like runs through the jungle, goes down a waterfall, flies through the air with butterflies. I don't know. It's pretty cool. So the whole family celebrating Antonio's gift and they pose for a photo. But guess who's not in the photo? They do not include Mirabelle.
That's so mean.
Fucking rude. Everyone in this movie. You know what? Maybe nobody fucks. They all.
Yeah.
But I will say this song grew on me over the last little while. It wasn't my favorite off the top, and it still isn't my favorite, but I do enjoy it.
It's kind of forgettable.
I think so too. It's called Waiting on a Miracle.
A lot of the themes, I would say this watch through is only been my second watch through watching Encanto. And it's a lot of the themes. And now that I know what's happening in the movie, it struck with me more than it did the first time watching it. So this song is such a big I want song. This is like the whole reason why Mirabelle, like, she's been trying to keep it together this entire time, but she is feeling the weight of not having power. She talks about, like, she can't control the weather. She's not super strong. She can't hear like a pin drop. And she's the only real one trying to be like positive in the family and keep everyone together. It's a huge, huge theme for her character in this movie, is bringing people together. So like this song struck more with me when knowing that.
And is the song driving home? Because where I get muddied with this song is like, is she, because this, we've already set up with this first chunk of the movie that like she is fine not having powers. It's all about her family. So, okay, the miracle that she's singing about then, it's not like, oh, I'm waiting on a miracle. Like I want a gift like everyone else got from the door. The miracle she wants is for her family to fucking lay off her. Like, is that the miracle?
I think the miracle is that she wants change, because like her entire family is so stuck in like how things are and not accepting what things can be.
Well, and to me, it's like finding her place in the family. Like a miracle would be her feeling like she belongs.
Right.
She doesn't feel that.
Yeah, even though she's been trying to say that she does, she's deep down not at all. That's why I think I appreciate the song more. But again, like melody-wise, the other songs coming up are way better. But this song's grown on me.
Yeah, I appreciate what it's doing and whatever. But yeah, I think as a song, it's not one that I'm going to really put on and listen to and like belt along with.
Well, we'll see. But give it another year or so.
Speaking of holding things together, this is when the house begins to... cracks start to spread everywhere. The power surges. The magic candle almost goes out. And then suddenly the family rushes out to where Mirabelle is. But the cracks are all gone. And she's like, did she imagine it? The house is fixed. What's going on? And there's sort of this like shameful moment where the family is like, Mirabelle, don't make a scene. You're embarrassing us. And they just sort of say to everybody, just ignore her. She doesn't know what she's talking about. And it's kind of crushing for our girl Mirabelle.
Especially how Abuela always gets on Mirabelle's
case. A piece of work.
She really gets on Mirabelle's case about stuff. Yeah. And these scenes are like a little heartbreaking.
So Mirabelle talks to her mom, who gives her some. So the other thing to mention is that actually Mirabelle cut her hand on part of the house on like a shattered tile or something like that. So she has this cut on her hand, and that's how she knew that she didn't imagine it was real. And because her mother's a healer, she makes her some agape, something, some really yummy something con queso, and that heals her. But they're having a nice chat too, and her mother mentions Bruno and how he kind of fell away from the family. So we're very, very slowly getting these mentions of Bruno, but we don't really know much about him. Shortly after that, Mirabelle hears Abuela praying and realizes that Abuela believes Mirabelle and is worried about the house and the magic. So that's when Mirabelle is like, I've got to fix this miracle. But how do you fix a miracle, my friends?
Save the magic.
How do you fix magic? I don't know. So she decides to start by talking to Dolores, because Dolores hears everything. And so Dolores denies knowing anything about this, but she kind of hints at like, maybe we should talk to Luisa. So at breakfast the next day, the family is discussing Isabella's impending engagement to Mariano. Will you?
No, I don't think so. No. Is that what you're saying? No.
It's one of those things where like,
I don't think
you
so.
Really want him to, but there's not a lot there.
No,
he's very needy, as we've established by the end of the movie.
What about Dolores?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Big time.
Big time.
Not even a question.
So at breakfast, Mirabelle realizes that Luisa is hiding something, and so she confronts her. And that's when we get, I don't know, the hit song of 2021, Surface Pressure. Service. I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can be of service. A flaw or a crack, the straw in the stack that breaks the camel's back. What breaks the camel's back? It's pressure like a drip, drip, drip that'll never stop. Pressure. Whoa. Pressure that'll tip, tip, tip till you just go bosh. Whoa. Give it to your sister, your sister's older. Give her all the heavy things. Surface Pressure.
Okay, guys,
Is this like Black Horse favorite track? Is Black Horse the right?
Dark Horse.
Dark Horse.
I don't think it's really Dark Horse, but.
Well, I feel like the other song that we'll get to became the big hit, but this to me is the best song.
I go back and forth, but I think the other songs are more technically impressive. There's a lot of things going on about it that makes it whoa, this is insane that it was even made. But Surface Pressure, just hearing it, it's very, very catchy and very real.
I feel like when we first listened to it, Brad was like, fuck.
Lyrically and as a storytelling piece, this song is mind-blowing. The lyric that I wrote down is, I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can't be of service. That's in a fucking children's movie, my friend.
I know.
Oh my god. It's
one after the other with those lyrics, just talking about her insecurities and how she needs, I feel like everybody can relate to Louisa. That's the thing.
Also, they could have, if you took these lyrics and made them a ballad, and gave them to Celine Dion or something like that. I'm on the floor in tears, crying, saying, take my money, Celine. I think I can't wait for the what do you call it? The ballad cover of this song. Where it just turns it into an emotional masterpiece.
I think they've already done that.
I haven't heard it.
I think it's on YouTube.
It's not as good as this, the OG though, man. This is my go-to start a workout song as well.
It's
the first song I put on, and man, I remember being mindful the first time we watched it. It finished, and Brad and I were both just whoa, what was that? That was amazing. And I feel after that, the next song also blows my mind, but this stuck with me. And then on this second watch, I was crying in tears. I think the animation in this number too is so fucking good. It's so fast paced and just goes with the song so well. So good.
I'm sure you'll get into animation angle, but this entire movie looks fucking great. Mm-hmm. But especially with it's interesting with this music, and I was laughing with Laura. All the songs are a music video. In this song, Surface Pressure, Louisa's literally punching mountains and she's lifting the world and she's lifting the entire Coliseum, but that's not actually happening. And Mirabelle's on the adventure with her, which I really like about Encanto is that it's just so unapologetically a musical movie. Mm-hmm.
Aladdin's friend like me.
It doesn't have
to. You're welcome from Moana.
Yeah, none of it has to obey the laws of the world or anything. It's but it's just a music video now, and it's great for
it. Songs can kind of exist in different universes. Yeah. I think the thing that gets me is that I was talking about how oh my god, this song would be amazing as a ballad, but the fact that it's not, Louisa, she can't show, even when she's trying to express her emotions, which she's doing through the lyrics, she still has to have that very solid and stony and firm front, which is sort of I think the style of the music of this song, because she that's who everyone expects her to be. So even when she's I can't do this, she's still kind of upholding that front, which is very...
And as a ballad, you don't get the contrast, though, to the one verse where it shakes things up and they're in the clouds and she's wait if I can take... And it's that's on purpose, you know? Yeah. I've watched the video essays on this song where it's the beats and stuff, and it's you need the fast pace of this song to build up to that moment and then to crash down
contrast
from
is
it.
Key.
Yeah,
oh,
so true.
This song's amazing. 10 out
of
10.
It's so good.
I'm going to read it again. I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can't be of service. That hits hard.
Stop.
The whole song does.
So Louisa confesses to Mirabelle that when Mirabelle was saying that she saw cracks in the house, Louisa felt weak. And this is a concern because the family relies on Louisa to be strong. So she tells Mirabelle that she overheard grown-ups talking about this terrible vision that Bruno had. So she thinks that Bruno may have the answer. Mirabelle thinks that Bruno may have the answer. So she goes looking for him. So she goes into this sand area. Sand. Shh. And she gets stuck in a room. But in this room under the sand, she notices these kind of little glowing things. So she digs them all up, and they're these pieces of a puzzle, and she puts a few of them together and sees herself. So she's like, oh my gosh, what is this? So she grabs the rest of them and she races out just as this whole sand palace place is like crumbling around her, but she makes a narrow escape. And then when she gets out, Abuela confronts her, but then the two of them are distracted by Luisa confessing that she is losing her powers. So things are going downhill fast. And then Peppa overhears Mirabelle saying Bruno's name, but she's like, no, no, we don't talk about Bruno. You can't. I'm not going to answer any questions. We don't talk about him. And then she launches into a song about him, where she is talking about Bruno through a song called We Don't Talk About Bruno. No, no, no.
Man,
cultural reset.
This
I think this blew my mind in a way I had not had my mind blown in a while.
This is so interesting actually hearing that from you, Sam, because I remember I think you let some stuff slip when you first watched the movie, and I know you love Surface Pressure, as you should, and I think it still is your favorite song out of all of them.
It is,
but it didn't sound like you liked this song in our chat when we had it.
I thought so too. I was worried.
I thought you're like, you just didn't think it was impressive.
Oh, no, no.
No, 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 no.
No, 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 no. As soon as that song ended, when they get basically at the near the end of the song, when they're all shifting the plates on it and like singing their parts, I was like fucking dead on the couch. Like,
that's what I mean. Like Lin-Manuel just being an absolute monster when it comes to just like, it's so crazy to think of In the Heights, Hamilton, Moana, and then this, even like Mary Poppins stuff. Like the way he crafts music is so well thought out that I can't even like imagine what's going on in his brain as he's creating stuff.
Quick tangent, you know that he's doing music for Little Mermaid, right?
I did not know that.
Alan Menken.
That's nuts.
Are doing music for Little Mermaid. It's gonna that be is amazing. Nuts. Yeah. This song, I don't have words for it. Like something very physical happens inside me when I hear them saying 7 foot frames for so long is better.
Okay, Sam, you don't even know. Like ever since watching the first, like we weren't allowed to talk about the whole movie, but every now and then Laura would be cooking and just out of nowhere she goes 7 foot frames for action, and she would just launch into that no matter what.
So good. I don't even know how to do a body roll, but I do a body roll.
I just love anytime anyone's like saying anything, just like, but.
Yeah, but. It was my wedding day.
It was our wedding day. Oh.
Cloud in this.
No clouds allowed.
And I love Dolores's part. I'm just like, I put this song on earlier. I was like, just like jamming in my living room, like.
Also, the how long did it take you all to get the rhythm of what is the line that Felix sings? I'm sorry, mi vida, go on. That bit. It took me so long to figure out that bit because it's like the tempo's kind of weird. Beats.
Yeah. After Peppa sings,
I
think.
Oh my gosh. I worked very hard.
I have a huge did you know for this for later. This song. I will talk about why this song is very good.
I can't wait.
But we can just like generally discuss like this song beat out like Let It Go. That is insane. And you think about how big Let It Go was when it first came out for non-Disney fans alike. I remember non-Disney people were tuning into the radio, tuning into just like being like, look at Let It Go. It is just an incredible song. And then We Don't Talk About Bruno, numbers wise, completely blew Let It Go out of the water. And now it's the number one Disney song, which is pretty insane to think about, honestly, out of all of them.
Did any of you see the tweet that was like, I think it was a screen cap of Lin-Manuel texting one of the writers of the movie and was like, what do you think of this list of names? And one of them responded, I like Bruno. He's like, yeah. Oh, so good. It couldn't have been anything else but Bruno.
Also, I know Laura watched this, right? I'm pretty sure you saw this, but like last year at the Oscars, they did this super cringe rendition of it, and it was so bad. And it was like, don't talk about the Oscars. It was so bad.
You know who also did? It was even worse. Non-surprisingly, James Corden also did it. We don't talk about Bruno situation, but it was much more like, it was in the tune of We Don't Talk About Bruno, but it was for something that was extremely relevant at the time. I don't remember exactly, but I want to say it was like a Kardashian thing.
Yeah.
So it's like, we don't talk about Kim or Kanye. It's stop.
And the interesting thing, like speaking of the Oscars, is that like this is the most popular song from the movie. This is the most popular Disney song of all time, right? But this is not the song that they put forward for best song.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later. Movie,
so. Yeah, we'll get there. We'll get there.
It is interesting. I think.
But do you think it would have won? Do you think that We Don't Talk About Bruno would have stood a stronger chance than the other song?
Maybe. It's
do
a
we
maybe.
Know what won that year? Do you know?
Yeah, it was Billie Eilish's
James Bond song.
James Bond song.
Every time they just like get a famous person to sing a song for a James Bond movie and it automatically wins an Oscar.
Skyfall was actually
good. It drives me bananas. Yeah, but writing it on
Skyfall
the wall
was good.
Should not have beat the song that I can't remember what I said right now, but Writings on the Wall should not have won.
Sure.
I'm fine.
We Don't Talk About Bruno. It's such a multi-layered song that I will get into later, but
I put my phone down because I forgot that I got so wrapped up in that.
I do think that Bruno should have been up for an Oscar just because the amount of work to write a song like that, it seems more impressive. The other one holds emotional weight and we'll get there, but like this one, I think technically speaking, is just like a masterpiece.
That's why I was talking about Surface Pressure versus this. Like, I think Surface Pressure is much more, in a way, poppy and just much more digestible. Like, anybody can listen to it and appreciate it. Where We Don't Talk About Bruno, like, when you start thinking about what's going on in the song, is much more technically impressive, like you said.
Yeah. And this is much more exposition song, as the other two are more like feelings and themes and whatever.
100%. So.
All right, we gotta move on.
Yeah, we do.
Okay, so at the end of the song, Mirabelle's dad walks in on her putting the glowing pieces together and he freaks out. It's really quite funny, actually, because the vision shows the magic failing and the house falling apart. So he says to Mirabelle, like, this never happened. Nobody needs to know. But who's on the other side of the slightly ajar door? Well, on the other side, but also across the whole house, but she has really good hearing. Is Dolores. So Dolores knows, and at dinner there's a deeply comedic moment where Mirabelle is trying to convince Dolores, using only her eyes, to just keep it together, woman. And briefly eye contact is broken and suddenly the house is cracking and so is Dolores.
She tells
Carmelo. The news makes it all the way around the table. By the way, this is supposed to be Isabella and Mariano's engagement dinner. Family's there. Both families are there. There's this hilarious bit where they're like, Luisa, get the piano. Luisa's like in tears trying to pull the piano into the room because her strength is gone. The house is falling apart and everything is basically ruined. And so Mirabelle then follows these rats that are escaping with the pieces of the vision that they stole from her. And she discovers this passageway behind a painting.
Well, doesn't Abuela find out about like all of this first? Because like as the dinner is kind of getting out of control and like
Mariana's family leaves
and Peppa, her cloud, makes rain at the table and all this other stuff. Mirabelle's trying to collect the pieces and then like it all gets shoved into Abuela's face, right? And that's how she sees it.
I don't remember that, but that doesn't mean it didn't happen.
Okay. I think that's what happened. And then
like
she
the pieces are together and Abuela sees them
and
together.
And she sees what Mirabelle's
Okay, gotcha. So so Mirabelle follows these rats. She finds a passageway that's hidden behind a painting and she spots Bruno. So then she's chasing him. He jumps over this huge gap and she's like, I'm brave, I can do it. And she tries but then she falls and she's barely hanging on to this one pole, preventing herself from falling into the pit. And the casita, she's like, casita, help me, doesn't help her. But Bruno saves her. But then like Bruno jumps in the pit and it's like 1 foot below where Mirabelle's feet are. So that's kind of fun. And then we learn that Bruno is very superstitious and he's sort of like walking away from her, knocking on wood, throwing salt over his shoulder. And Mirabelle notices all of these patches in the cracks of the house. And she realizes that Bruno has been patching these cracks as they appear. He's trying to fix the house for the family. And in fact, he never left the house. He left his room and then went and kind of was living in the walls. He set up this dining table on the other side of the wall from the family's dining table.
Sam's crying.
So he can watch them eat dinner through a tiny hole and kind of eat with them.
Wait. Oh. Pause here. Sam, how did you feel here?
I was not crying, but I love Bruno. I do. Yeah. I'm like, oh man, like he's so like deranged and just, I mean, understandably, like given all he's like gone through, but I feel like that's what this movie really does. They're like, listen, like people are the way they are because of their experiences.
Yeah.
And so Bruno being, I mean, they really amp up how like crazy he is with his like bucket on his head and like the, like they do a lot of like crazy things with Bruno because it's a cartoon, but it's like yeah it's like okay, you also like saw into the future and your mind is probably jumbled mess, so like I get it, but I do I really like Bruno.
Yeah, I would say like him, I mean, hanging out with rats the entire time, you know, and having that little crack to see that his family's eating and then making a little table for himself, I felt it because I'm like, man, that's just, he loves his family so much. And you will see later that he sacrificed so much of his last few years or whatever for his family, even at the expense of his family basically exiling him and shutting him out. But that doesn't matter, right? So,
and one of the things that's being sort of hinted at with all of the other family members is that is like the element of the gifts as burdens. And I think Bruno's is the most clear version of that, where like he tells people want their prophecies. So he gives them to them and then they blame him for them.
He told me my fish would die.
The next day, dead. Yeah. So they're like, yeah, you killed my fish.
My hair.
Like, no, like I didn't kill your fish. You asked me what was going to happen. And I told you what was going to happen. And then it was that your fish was going to die. So,
and then the other guy had a big gut.
Yeah. That's not Bruno's fault, you know? Okay, so Bruno tells Mirabelle that Abuela asked him to look into the future on the day that Mirabelle didn't get a gift. So when the ceremony failed and Mirabelle didn't get a gift, Abuela said, Bruno, like, I need to see what's up. And that's sort of, I think, where the fracture happened between the family and Bruno ended up leaving. And so Mirabelle's solution to this problem is for Bruno to have another vision. And he's like, no, I
can't. To protect Mirabelle.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So she's like, have another vision. And he's like, do you remember what my last vision did? No, we can't do that. Plus, I need a ton of space. And then little Antonio appears out of nowhere because the rats told him what was going on. Of course, rats are on. meanwhile, outside, a storm is brewing and people are becoming anxious. So there's a lot going on in the village and in the casita. So Mirabelle and Bruno and Antonio use Antonio's room for the vision, but Bruno is expressing his worry that people are going to blame whatever happens on him as if he causes them, which we know isn't the case. So anyways, he agrees to do it. He has this vision, and in the vision, the family's magical candle goes out, the house cracks, and everyone is in danger. But he wants to end it. Mirabelle's like, no, we need to see what else there is. We need to see like if there's a solution. And so this sort of yellow light appears and they kind of follow it through this vision. And ultimately it's determined that Mirabelle must embrace Isabella to save the magic. But one important note is that as this vision is happening, Bruno does say it's all out of order. And I should mention that the yellow light turned out to be a butterfly. So ultimately, we saw this vision, but we don't really know how it happens. And the takeaway is that Mirabelle has to give Isabella a hug. So she's like, all right, I guess I'll go get her to hug me. So she tries to get Isabella to embrace her, but instead they end up fighting. And through this giant fight, Isabella confesses that she doesn't even want to marry Mariano. And in doing so, her anger creates not flowers, but a cactus. And so then she sings the song, What Else Can I Do? Not symmetrical or perfect, but it's beautiful and it's mine. What else can I do? Wait, bring it in, bring it in.
I really like this song. I really like this
I thought
song.
It was really forgettable the first time I saw it, but then I was like, okay, sure. And then I really liked it when I watched it this time. And then today I like had to put it on when I was in the living room and I was like, I need to dance around.
The bridge of this song sounds straight off of Alanis Morissette album.
Which one? Which part?
What's her famous album? You know the one, Jagged Little Pill. The bit where she's like, deliver us a river of sundown. Can I deliver us?
Yo, but I feel like it sounds like a like Hillary Duff pop song, like that era.
I think
like,
the rest of it, the bridge
is extremely good. Call and response with Mirabelle in the song too, because Mirabelle gets to have her own little like bring it in. But also like there's a great breakdown in the I would call that the bridge of the song where like Mirabelle's like.
That's actually stealing from Bruno. He told me that the life of my dreams
was
boring.
I think the song's so good. It's so good.
That's a great part too. Maybe there's two bridges.
But like it's very quick because like you go from like a Isabella who does not like her sister to an Isabella who loves her sister by the end of the song.
It is very
so like
fast.
If you think about like story wise, I guess it breezes by very quickly. But oh man, I think it's just melodically very catchy.
And
also lyrically very deep.
And this is another confession of like the burden of her gift of she always had to be perfect, so she felt like she had to marry Mariano. Even though she didn't want to, she was doing it for the family. And so that's the confession that kind of sets this off and allows Isabella to discover these other elements of herself, not just making the most beautiful flowers, but maybe making something unusual, something different, and in turn, like making herself different from what people expect of her.
And like that's like why this song and Surface Pressure are such a good insight to the human psyche, and especially in like 2022 when people's mental health are much more aware of what's happening inside of them and stuff like that. So like contextualizing that you don't have to be perfect in like what you do in your world, you just have to have it exist or let your truth just be what it is. Like it is a very Disney message. And I think it's very important to like share with the younger generation.
Mm-hmm. I think on that note, it's like, all these songs, I was like, every song in this movie feels like a therapy session. I feel like all therapy. Yeah.
But good, it's good.
In a good way,
Yeah. So as Isabella is discovering this something new that she can do, she sort of covers the house and herself in this colorful dust, and Mirabelle and Isabella hug and the candle burns brighter than ever. But then Abuela comes in and she is furious. So she thinks the house is a mess. She just kind of lets loose on Mirabelle saying, this is all your fault. You're the reason that our family is having these issues. You're the reason the house is cracking. The house is falling. And Mirabelle defends herself to Abuela. But as she's defending herself, the house starts to fall apart around them. And everyone realizes the candle's going to go out. So we have to save the candle. Mirabelle manages to climb up and grab it. The house protects her as it's falling apart. But then after she retrieves it and gets down to safe ground, the candle burns out and the Encanto is broken. And then Mirabelle disappears and the family goes looking for her. We discover that she's escaped to a river and it is Abuela who finds her. And Abuela tells Mirabel that this river is where the miracle started and where Abuelo Pedro died. So this is a very important spot to their family. And that's when they play the song Dos Oruguitas.
Ay, oruguitas, no se aguanten más. Hay que crecer, aparte y volver. Hacia adelante seguirás. Vienen milagros, vienen crisálidas. Hay que partir y construir su propio futuro. Ay, oruguitas, no se aguanten más. Hay que crecer, aparte y volver. Hacia adelante seguirás. Vienen milagros, vienen crisálidas. Hay que partir y construir su propio futuro.
Okay.
Can I? What did I miss,
Sam? Yeah. Go, Sam.
Okay.
I wasn't going to say anything.
You're talking about the song, right?
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I was.
Yeah.
The song started last night, and I was like, in a sassy way, I was like, oh, yeah, and this is the one that went up for an Oscar. And then I was like, bawling.
I honestly think that this is the best song Lin-Manuel's ever written. It is my favorite.
Yeah,
I think it's so beautiful.
It is.
I think it's so stunning.
It is a very beautiful song. There's so much to this song that's so emotional, thinking about, especially how they integrate it with the story and how...
The animation in it is very, like, insane as well.
I was telling Laura that the part that crushes me is seeing Abuela's face completely shatter and break, seeing her husband die off screen. You see it in her, like, facial reaction hasn't happened forever, but she's just completely in tears and you feel it.
Mm-hmm.
And then the music that's swelling during this, and then
I'm like crying,
seeing the miracle be born out of this passion and love that she has for her husband. A lot of this of this moment
and
really
it's
works.
Like,
yeah,
go ahead, Sam.
It's like a mirror. Sam needs a moment. No, but it's like Mirabel getting it too, right? It's like it's sad because it's sad, but it's also like this touching moment where Mirabel's like, fuck, man, like I get it, like,
and there's so many layers to it. Like, there's like, as the audience, we're seeing the story of Mirabel's family portrayed on screen, and specifically what happened with Abuela and Abuelo Pedro. And so presumably, like, it's Abuela giving Mirabel the full story of their family. But the lyrics aren't, well, first of all, they're in Spanish, so many of us who are listening don't actually know what the lyrics are saying. So it's just kind of a nice compliment to the visuals that we're getting. But if you actually like read the lyrics of the song, or if you listen to them and understand them, it's a completely like it's sort of an allegory, I guess, of like these caterpillars that need to grow apart so that they can become butterflies before they come back together. And that's not really like the story of Abuela and Abuelo, or of the family. I guess you could kind of say it's Abuela and Mirabel, but it's just sort of like this beautiful song that's not necessarily exposition of the story in any way, which we've seen for all of the other songs. Like, all of the other songs are very character focused and are like, this is who this person is. This is just like a stunningly beautiful song that tells the story from beginning to end in its own right. That's just sort of a gorgeous backdrop to what's happening on the screen. And I think I cherish that about it because it's so different from what we're used to seeing in Disney movies.
Yeah, I don't know for sure. I'm sure someone has deconstructed the lyrics of the song and tied
and
it back
into how it relates to the story.
Yeah, because like,
don't they play it in English in the credits?
They do.
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
But Abuela's symbol is a yellow butterfly. Mm-hmm. We'll see that in, I'll talk about Mirabel's clothing later, but like this symbol that represents Abuela is the yellow butterfly. What it symbolically means, I'm not sure if I'm smart enough to like, or at least I've only seen the movie twice, so I didn't see it in that context yet. This time watching it was really just like appreciating all of what her, Abuela, has gone through as a character.
Yeah.
And you start understanding, because like, she, on the surface, if you had to name a physical villain of the movie, it would have been Abuela.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But there's no physical villain of the movie. There's like a metaphorical villain of the movie. So to see her point of view and how she's got there through this song, you very much empathize with Abuela. And then seeing Mirabelle also do the same and them understanding each other and why they've both kind of been hard on each other. It's really something.
And I'm sure there was some intention behind it in terms of like who the butterflies are. So the song title is Dos Oruguitas, which means two caterpillars, and they turn into butterflies in the song. And so I think you might make the argument that like, okay, these two caterpillars are like abuela and abuelo, and maybe they'll come back together in the afterlife sort of thing. Or maybe it's abuela and Mirabelle, and they like are on these diverging paths, but they come together in the end once they kind of discover the importance of family and that sort of thing. But I guess I just like that it's not explicit, and it's just like
a
beautiful story in and of itself,
and a beautiful song. Like I learned this was one of the first songs I learned on ukulele. And I really, that's what it's called. Laura makes fun of me. It's called an ukulele. People call it a ukulele. Yeah. It's an ukulele. Yeah. Say it right. Anyways, I learned this song and I really enjoyed playing it because it's very simple, but very beautiful.
It was like stuck in my head the whole next day. And then I was like, I'm going to watch it. And then I cried again.
It's so like heart, like it's moving, right? Like if there's something to it.
When they both climb up on the lampposts.
I think it's
shout out to Jack the Leary.
No,
Jack the Leary. I think it's moving in a way as well that like we're just starting to see now more in film, and I'm gonna miss one of them. Maybe Mitchell's versus Machines, yeah, and then like this, and we'll get there with Turning Red eventually. But it's just like that, like coming to terms like with generational trauma stuff that like they're starting to do, because I feel like now like our people our age are the ones in charge of making movies now. And I've seen it, I forget what the term was, but it was like something and they basically like labeled it a fantasy because everyone's like, yeah, we would love to like have these moments with our grandparents, totally. But it's not. And so I think it's like this emotional moment too, because we're like, oh my god, we're not super used to seeing this kind of like giant gesture.
Yes. Yes. A vulnerable abuela in real life is much.
Yeah.
Your Turning Red point is very good, because I feel the same way, where it's just like, oh man, the grandparents in this movie is exactly what we as a generation wish our grandparents would have said.
Yeah,
to us.
Yeah. And that's what makes it fantasy. Because you're like, totally, oh, like, totally. That's awesome.
But that's why it like hits so hard for like people like us and like everybody, really. Because it's like, I wish our parents' generation were better at like communicating their feelings. And maybe that would have helped us communicate our feelings better, you know, as adults.
Abuela to not only just communicate the trauma, because like they all probably knew the story, but for her to connect it to being like, this is my story that you kind of know, but this is why I'm the way. It's like Abuela acknowledging that that's why she is. And I think that's the moment. It's not just like, oh, here's this new story. It's like, oh my god, like I fucked you all up because of this, and like I'm sorry. So it's like this mutual understanding they're coming to, which is really powerful.
And as audience members, this is when we really discover that Abuelo actually sacrificed himself to save his family. So I think we knew from the beginning of the film that he was killed, but we didn't realize that like he went back to fight to prevent these people from attacking the Abuela and their family and the other villagers. So at this point, Abuela also apologizes to Mirabelle, which I think is really important.
It's so heartwarming.
And Mirabelle in turn tells Abuela, reminds her really that the miracle that the family has is because of her. The miracle is you, just you. So yeah, that happens. And I think that's like, that's an important thing for her to acknowledge. And so then we get the family reunion. Bruno is back and his sisters are so thrilled to see him again.
Didn't she tell Mirabelle like the miracle, like, was having Mirabelle in her life or something like that? Like she's,
I think she does, like, but then so I think she says to Mirabelle, like, you're a miracle, like you don't need a miracle, you are one. But then Mirabelle says back, like, but all of this is because of you.
Okay.
Is because of you.
So many feelings.
Family is reunited and they're like, we don't have a house, but Mirabelle, being the constant positive force that she is, says like, that's we can rebuild. And then the villagers come in and say like, and we can help you. And then they do it in a day. They fix that house in a day.
They literally do it in a day. It's like Springfield.
Yeah.
Like when they finally work together, it's like they actually are pretty good.
So the big symbolic moment at the end of this rebuilds, and who knows whether Isabella just really likes her outfit or whether it was only one afternoon, is that Mirabelle gets to install the new doorbell. And when she installs it, the house lights up and comes back to life, and Casita has returned.
But the song that happens back during the building, right? Like the whole
some gift, just you. Yeah, the miracle is you. That one?
Yeah.
Don't they say something about burning? Burn. Because I was like,
are you thinking of Hamilton, Sam?
No. That's why I said it, because I was like, oh, we're using the same. There is.
Yeah, there's a whole song of them building and stuff. I forget.
It reminds me a lot of the finale from In the Heights.
Yeah, something
and
like
that.
And
they sing about burn, and they use the old woman's voice from In the Heights that is not Abuela, but it's her singer voice.
Yeah.
Also, a lot of like, this is the song where they call back a lot of other songs for like a short period. Yeah. Like, what else can we do?
We don't shine, we burn.
Oh, yeah.
So, okay, if you haven't listened to the finale of In the Heights, listeners, you got to go listen to it, because there are so many similarities with this song.
What's the song called? I don't remember.
The finale. This song?
Yeah.
I don't know. The Miracle Is You?
Maybe it's that.
I'll look at it. Stars don't shine, they burn. The constellations glow. The seasons change in turn. Would you watch a little girl go? She takes after you. Oh. Hey, Mariana, why so blue? And then there's a party.
I remember liking the song, and like, obviously we don't remember it, so it's not like melodically rememberable, but I remember being like, oh, this is a good way to tie this movie together. Like,
I couldn't everyone's get past the together. Burn stuff.
Yeah, you're stuck on that.
All of you. Well, yeah, I think it's all of you.
All of you, yeah.
All of you. And that kind of leads into Hola Casita. No, that looks like it's a score piece.
I think that's like the actual credit song is the next song, where it's like
Colombia, mi encanto.
That's the one where it's like Colombia, yeah. I love you. Yeah. And that's the English translation.
And that's the movie.
Wow. Thank Encanto. You,
Wow, what did that take us, an hour and a half?
That was a shorter really summary. Long time. That was a shorter summary, my friend.
Well, it was a big family, you know. That was their whole fear for this movie. So we've can attest to it. So source material. This was an original story. I believe the story credits go to Jared Bush and Byron Howard, though I believe they had some other help as well. I know they visited Colombia, and I read that they also talked to a lot of therapists while writing the film, which is good research on both fronts. So, yeah, I'm sure Lin had maybe some things to say, given he was writing like songs and they really tie into the movie as well. So it is not based on anything before that. So did we like this movie, Tang?
Yeah, I would say I very much enjoyed it the second time around. I remember the first time I watched it, I did like it, but I needed to process it a little bit more. And then once I saw like a bunch of YouTube videos on the construction of the songs and like the themes of the movie, like it felt like I've only seen it twice, but between the first and second watch through, I only grew more fondness for Encanto, where when I immediately watched it, I probably said that was good.
Yeah.
But now I really think it's kind of great, to be honest.
I think this movie is better than you think it is. Like, however good you think it is, it's actually better than that. You know what
I mean?
Sure,
yeah.
It's got levels. It's got layers. There's a lot going on below the surface pressure.
It's very deep, but also doesn't, I mean, of course it treads some familiar Disney ground, but like the pacing of the movie, and like there's no villain of the movie, like even when you think it might end, it doesn't end right away. Like there's a lot of subverting of expectations, I think, that happens in this movie.
Even the stuff like with the vision, and you think it's going to be like the be-all end-all of the movie, And then you're like, wait a second, it's hugging Isabella. And then they do it. And it is this really big moment. But that's not the ultimate thing of the movie. It's like this reparation of the relationship with Abuela at the end. Right.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
There's just, it just sort of keeps going. Yeah. I think subverts expectations is a good way to describe it.
What about you, Sam?
Did you like it?
Yeah. So again, going into it, I wasn't that excited. And I remember leaving it being like, oh, I like that a lot more than I thought I did. I really liked two of the songs. And I was like, yeah, it was good. Like, I really liked two of the songs. But again, the more, much like you guys were just saying, the more I ruminated on it, I was like, yeah, mm-hmm. like that was really like a good kind of like story. And then the second watch through, I like liked it a lot more because it is like a mystery. And the songs, mm-hmm. I feel like there is a big gap between some, like the pacing of the songs. Sometimes I was like, I forget which one I had it written down. There's like a pretty big gap between two of them or something.
I think Surface Pressure and Bruno.
Yeah. I think that one. So it's a lot like just like of like what's going on here kind of thing. And it is a really tight, like she doesn't like leave the area. Like it's a very like close to home story. I don't know. Yeah. The more I think about it, the more I do genuinely like it. And I like the songs more every time I listen to them as well. So I will definitely watch it again as opposed to some of the other ones.
Yeah,
we've
for sure.
come to recently.
I think it's kind of what Lin-Manuel does, which is really impressive, is with a lot of his work. I'm not going to say all of his work, but a lot of his work has so much meat to it in a way that like it deserves multiple listens to his lyrics. And those are the things that makes his song better and stand out. Like that's why Hamilton is so good, right? The more we listen to it, the more we pick up on stuff that we never like thought about before. In Encanto, so many of these songs have just an incredible amount of layers and detail to it that you're not going to see the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth time, you know, like you have to keep kind of listening to it and then watching, like if you're invested, of course, like video essays as to why it's why it's
good. I live
good,
for
right?
video essays.
Yeah. And like, this movie in particular is perfect for it, for songs like Surface Pressure, for songs like Dos Oruguitas, like all of those songs. And of course we don't talk
and
about
they them. Just like unashamedly cover all these different genres. Like I guess it's all kind of poppy, but there's like what do you call it, you don't talk about Bruno almost has
is a madrigal movie.
Like is it a madrigal?
Yeah
I will
talk about it.
There's all kinds of different rhythms and types of music, and they just do whatever the heck they want.
You know what's also fun about this movie is that a lot of their music in the music that they're singing, they're dancing. Like, that's what I said about
I've got stuff on that as well.
Unapologetically
just, once
a
again,
musical.
I'd like to call some attention to Felix's hips. Look for them.
When was the last time we watched a movie where, well, I mean, I guess maybe Moana, like them.
For
like,
a character's hips?
No, just for them dancing while they're singing. Like, they're, like, as we don't talk about Bruno's going, like, think about when.
Like a musical.
When Mirabelle and Dolores are dancing to her verse.
Yeah.
It's very
it's true
like,
though. Moana doesn't dance. It's not a dancey musical. Yeah. Maybe like the first number.
Maui dances. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, Maui dances.
But like this song, people fucking dance, which is very fun.
Yeah. Also, back to Surface Pressure, because I'm never going to stop. When I like first listened to it too, I remember after that and being obsessed with it, I like put it on so much because I was like, I need to learn all the lyrics. So like as I was doing laundry, as I was cleaning the house, I had it on and it was like the perfect song to like keep me going for all these boring things I don't want to do too. So I was like cleaning my room and doing laundry and I just had it. I like literally played it on repeat. I was like one of those people. I'm just like, nope, listening to this like 1,000 times today. And yeah. I listened to it. And then, like I said, it was like my go-to like workout song. I just like put it on all the time. It's like my first song.
I'm not nervous.
Yeah. I'm not sick of it. I don't know that I can be.
Send it to me, Sam. So send me the did you know, and I'll start talking about Surface Pressure a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm not sending it quite yet because there was one thing I just meant to quickly touch on that I forgot about in the story thing, just that and I mean we've kind of touched on this, but as it's an original story, I guess there are like three main things that they were going for as well. They were like the three main themes we're touching on here are: one, most of us don't feel truly seen by our families; two, most of us carry burdens we never let our families see; three, most of us are oblivious that nearly all of us in the family, especially within the family, feel exactly the same way. So it's like just all about
Fuck, like, man, this movie.
Right? Right? So much. I think that's so much. That's so crazy. Real.
Oh my God. Yeah,
so real. So, sorry, that story, was all that.
Don't watch this with your family.
No, I want my family to watch this. I feel like I want to be like,
the problem is watching this with your family. I feel like you want them to understand what this movie is trying to say. And they'd be like, I don't know. I guess it's kind of pretty.
You're so right. Your mom would be like,
why does that woman have such really big muscles?
Yeah.
Why does she have such big muscles? It's not very pretty.
Yeah, I don't understand. Okay. Well, Tung, why don't you take us away to the Did You Knows?
I have a lot of Did You Knows, but I'm going to try to condense them. I won't say them all, but I will say with Louisa in particular and Surface Pressure, I do remember there was a period when this movie came out where they were fighting for more Louisa toys to be out into the market. The executives were like, nobody wants to see a big, strong girl.
They want Isabella.
They want the Barbie doll. And the Louisa doll sold way more than the Isabella doll. Like, people want to see different body types. They want to see a strong woman.
A strong woman who's vulnerable.
Vulnerable, yes. All of these things. So it was really kind of nice to see that, like,
I freaking love that.
Like, you know, Isabella is 100% supposed to be modeled after the Barbie girl, right? So cool to see Louisa is getting her time to shine. As she should.
Bouncing off that fact, fun fact, listeners at home that are maybe won't.
You're
going to
be Louisa
this.
For Halloween?
No, I'm not. But listeners at home, if you didn't already know this, I drew and designed Tung and Laura's wedding invitations.
Yeah, you did.
And on their second invitation, I designed Laura after Louisa. I stole her pose for the like angry, the strong pose. I referenced Louisa.
Is this when you drew me? And I was like, Sam, I just have one note. Could you make me look stronger?
I referenced Louisa, downplayed the muscles, and then Laura was like, can you give me more bones?
I freaking love that.
Louisa's a babe.
Auntie Laura's gotta be the strongest.
I love Louisa. And you, Laura.
I love you too.
So Stop it. Where's Brad on this podcast? I mean, I feel like Brad. This is the 60th episode, and we haven't had our new honorary Disney member.
Next week, we're gonna see Brad's episode. Okay, listeners, by the way, if you haven't listened yet,
out of order,
tune in to Ranked Top 5 List of Stuff That Don't Matter and watch the Top 5 Disney Movies episode, which we're gonna record next week.
Yeah, we'll see when that episode releases.
It's gonna be great.
It's gonna be great. Okay, so Sam alluded to this, and this is why we don't talk about Bruno, is I'm not gonna say it, but I might. It's like, it kind of is a masterpiece in many ways. Uh-huh. I think you can say that.
You don't need to hesitate.
And Sam mentioned that it is a madrigal, and it is. So what is that? So again, I'm not going to get into everything because there's like video essays on this where they deconstruct Lin-Manuel's thinking about all of this. We're talking also the family of Madrigal, like that's our last name. And then to have a song that incorporates what a madrigal is pretty incredible. So a madrigal is a song in which several people sing overlapping melodies, just as the families do in We Don't Talk About Bruno. This is actually a music style from the Renaissance where 2 to 8 singers each has different lyrics and all of them sing at the same time, which is called a polyphonic. Mm-hmm. And when you watch these video essays, which I did today, I watched like 3 of them, talking about We Don't Talk About Bruno, it's like, we talk about like Peppa's verse, which is like, not in a cloud in the sky, loud in the sky, and then 7-foot frame. And
so like, long is back.
All of these sound pretty different, right? But like, because they all follow the same musical structure overall, when they sing them at the same time, which is what they do at the very end of this song, it comes together in such a, I don't know, mesmerizing way. Like, how would you describe that?
This is like, so fans of Hamilton will know the song Nonstop, which is the Act One finale, which kind of does the same. I don't know if it's considered madrigal or not, but it basically, it does the same thing. But the fascinating thing about that is that there's like well over a dozen songs that he pulls from in Nonstop. But each of them exists as songs in their own right. And so he's kind of doing the same thing here, pulling in all these different themes from the different characters that have just been created within this song.
But it's more than just like, I would say like a reprise of some sort, or like just a callback to other songs, or like, what would you call it? Maybe it's just a reprise in a lot of like
I was going to say, Yeah, like when you're like just slam like them all together, listing them off.
Yeah, like at the end of the like act one of a Broadway musical, usually a medley of all the songs. It's more than just a medley because it all comes from the same song. It just makes
and they're stacked on top of each other as opposed to beside each other.
But that does happen in Nonstop too.
Sure. I think it's different than because I would consider Nonstop more of a medley, where this is feels like the description of what a madrigal is. But like the fact that it is called a madrigal and it's the family of madrigal, like there's already like a crazy amount of detail that he's thinking about. Yeah, the song's insane. There's more to say, but honestly, I wouldn't be able to explain.
Do you ever think about like what Lin-Manuel's frame of mind is when he's writing songs that are this good? Like, do you think he's like, oh, fuck, this is amazing. Like, people are going to love this.
Or
do you think he's like, a good song today?
So in these video essays, and again, please watch them because I'm not smart enough to talk about them on my own. Mm-hmm. But them saying what Lin has said in several interviews and stuff like that, he's very intentional about his lyrics. Obviously he is. But like even down to the name Bruno, of course, you're talking about, Laura, how Bruno was a name that someone just liked.
Yeah.
But also it is a name that rhymes with many things. So he's very cognizant of like, oh, Bruno rhymes a lot of things. We can go Bruno, no, which is very on theme to what this song's about. You're not supposed to talk about it, but you can't stop talking about it. Even the name Madrigal or Mirabelle was very intentional because Mirabelle rhymes with what he said, magical, fantastical, which you also hear in the song Family of Madrigal. Like, that's a whole conversation we can have about like the nuance of it. But I think it's really cool to think that his big hit song was in fact a madrigal.
There's like an episode of Sound Recorder, which is like people talking about their famous songs. And the one on Lin-Manuel is not an Encanto song, but it's a Hamilton number and it's for Wait for It. And he like talks in it about how he was like on his way to a party when like ideas were coming to him. So he just like left and went home because he had to like write the song. And I was like, that's crazy.
Thank you, Lin, for the sacrifice. Out.
He did write his way out.
That's my favorite song on Hamilton, Wait for It.
Wrote your way out. Okay, I'll continue. So that's impressive on its own. This is interesting. It was a very conscious decision and deliberate that Mirabelle would not have a comical sidekick in this movie.
Because we're so used to seeing those Pascal and Olaf and Genie.
Yeah, it did not happen. She's the first Disney character or female character to wear a main Disney character to wear glasses. Fun. This is a really fun one that I thought is Mirabelle, and you'll notice this in the movie, maybe next time you watch it, is Mirabelle always dances. We see that, right? Remember when she goes like casita floors like in that song, and she's like telling casita to do all these cool things to make it more danceable. She always dances to her own beat whenever she's alone, but anytime she's with somebody else, she tries to match the rhythm of dancing to the other person to show that how much she like has an empathetic nature to everyone naturally. You think about Dolores, and we don't talk about Bruno, she completely launches into trying to understand Dolores through dancing. I think that's fucking cool.
Correct.
Cool. I also think that's fucking
cool. It's just cool.
I think this movie, it just feels like, to quote Harry Styles, this movie just feels like a movie. Like, I mean that in the way that it's like, this is what I like appreciate about feature film. Like, I feel like sometimes people, especially in animation, and I got even asked this today, where it's like, oh, is your Disney's opening a studio in Vancouver and it's going to be a feature studio apparently. And someone asked me if like, oh, are you going to like try and go out there? Like, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, I don't know. Like, probably not like at this time. We'll see how it goes out there, but whatever. But I think thought has gone into the last few movies, but I feel like this movie stood out as one of the ones where it's like, yeah, like all the things we're talking about going into these characters and the like thought and like time put in and all of this is so impressive. And that is what I want to like come into. That is what I want to expect from a Disney movie, is like that kind of thinking. Yeah, that kind of intention behind characters. Yeah. And like, I want to go into a movie where it's like, yeah, they've thought about all of this stuff.
Yeah,
they put
detail into things that most people would not see detail in on their first watch through.
But you feel it. You are always going to feel it because it was
there.
And just
hearing about it later is very cool. Like, yeah, it, yeah, exactly. Here's some more did you knows. Stephanie Beatriz was originally going to be offered the role of Louisa.
Oh.
And what apparently happened, of course, people, you can correct me. These are IMDb facts. I don't
not verified.
I don't fucking know. But it sounded cool. When the production people met with Stephanie Beatriz, they're like, oh, you're not like Rosa Diaz.
Rosa Diaz, you know, yeah.
Like, everyone thinks Stephanie, this is the thing, right? It's very jarring because Stephanie Beatriz does such a good job being Rosa Diaz in Brooklyn Nine-Nine that anytime you see her in anything else, even in The Heights, she's a much more bubbly character in The Heights, much more like, I'm going to say dumb blonde energy, but I don't mean it in that way. She's very like bubbly and very like,
she's like
in a way
a neighborhood lady.
Sure.
Who's she's a gossip. She's she's like in everybody's business.
Yeah. And then in this movie, she's the most
sweet,
like positive and sweet character possible.
Also, never in a million years would I have guessed that this is Stephanie Beatriz's voice based on the sound of her voice, because I only
in
know her as Rosa
Diaz. Yeah, but she's an incredible singer. She kills it. She fucking kills it. So yeah, she was supposed to be Louisa, but they gave it to another woman. I forget her name, but she also
Jessica something. Yeah,
yeah, she does a great job on YouTube. She does a surface pressure like slow melodic thing that you're talking about, Laura. I will say with like what Sam said, like even though it is good, it's like a trombone, like a brass section type of like jazzy thing.
That's not what I'm looking for.
The original song just slaps much harder, like the poppy version.
I'd want to hear like a completely reimagined melody. Yeah. Like I wouldn't want to hear a ballad version of this melody. I would want it to be different. I also want to say that I think Stephanie Beatriz was such a good casting choice because she doesn't have the strongest voice, and I think that contributes to, like, she has a beautiful voice, but it's like she's not like Kristen Bell has a great voice, but like Idina Menzel is who I was trying to say, right? So I think that contributes to the sense of vulnerability that is such an appealing part of Mirabelle and such a core point of this story too.
Yeah,
I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, fair enough.
Appreciated it.
The conversation between Abuela and Mirabelle towards the end of the movie happens in a multicolored river. Although it seems more like a visual element of the movie, the fact that it's a real place in Colombia, it's called Cano Cristales, I might be saying that wrong, and is one of the most beautiful places in the country. Apparently, a special permit is needed to visit it, and only a few people are allowed to visit it each year. So cool to see that this fantastical place actually exists in the real world. Each magical member of the Madrigal family has a recurring symbol on their clothes that represents their gifts. You might notice that Julieta's apron has images of plants in the pockets, hands holding plants representing her healing powers through her recipes. Peppa wears sun-shaped earrings, blah blah blah. Bruno has hourglasses on his poncho mirroring his ability to see through the sands of time. And you're gonna, like, every character has that. But also in Mirabelle's clothing, which I think is very cool, Mirabelle, if you look very closely at her stitch clothing, or especially her dress, every single character in her family is represented on her dress. So watch for that next time. You'll see, like,
it's like insane that she has the stitching.
Yeah.
Because, like, guys, listeners, like, you have to animate every stitch. Like, that's fucked up.
It is fucked. I mean, I can't even imagine because Sam's the real animator here, obviously.
I can just imagine the directors being like, we have this great idea where the stitches are each going to be represented different family, and the animators just slowly having the life sucked out of them.
Textures on clothing are like, I mean, texture is one thing, but like, that kind of like specific stitching is like
it's like, again, an interesting theme, things that people don't think about, right? Like Mirabelle, I saw an essay about how Mirabelle is the conductor of the family, just like how Abuela is. Abuela was the person who also didn't have powers. Mirabelle and Abuela have way more in common than they let like each other know about until the end of the film. So like passing on the baton of the thread that like brings everyone together, Abuela to Mirabelle, is very interesting. And to have that thread embedded into Mirabelle's clothing is just like another layer of like, holy shit, someone really thought about this to a level that, like, again, I'm saying to you guys on Disney Dummies, like, we've watched the movie. I thought I understood it pretty well, but like the detail is freaking crazy, right? So look at Mirabelle's dress next time. Every single character in her family is represented in there. It is nuts. Apparently, the family of Madrigal was in inspired, I'm not sure if this is true, by Beauty and the Beast's Belle.
Expand.
Okay, yeah. I'll expand. Apparently, what? It's because that song is all about introducing the community and all that other stuff.
The song. I thought you meant their family.
So the family of Madrigal song was inspired by like
there
that.
There goes type. The baker with his
Yeah. Well, I feel like it's a very opening number-esque thing to do to introduce
but
everybody.
But also establishing like this place in this time. Like,
walking through the village.
Yeah. Like you have so much to do in this movie that doing exposition through song is the only way to get through.
You're gonna need a montage.
A mother freaking montage.
Composer Lin-Manuel Miranda states that the song Surface Pressure was inspired by his older sister Luz. Speaking with the Washington Post, he states, "She takes on way more responsibility than I do. I was very aware that I was the baby brother who got away with everything. So Surface Pressure is very much a love letter to my sister," which is very nice.
Stop it, Lynn.
Yeah. A few more fun things here is that there is hidden Mickeys in this film. And apparently there's hidden Mickeys in a lot of films, which I feel like... maybe we should have made a segment through not introduce it in episode 60.
I'm over it.
But it's like a cacti plant takes the form of Mickey Mouse. During Waiting on a Miracle, a similar shape can be seen in the fireworks. Like Mickey is kind of everywhere. There's apparently a Fantasia reference too in Bruno's den, a picture of what appears to be the sorcerer Mickey can be seen on the wall. Lots of like nods to like Disney stuff. Like there, the plant from WALL-E apparently makes an appearance. Interesting stuff. Oh, here it is. So I'll be a little bit more specific on the stitches on Mirabelle is my last fact here. So Mirabelle has a symbol of everyone, like I just said. Clouds for Peppa, flowers for Isabella, animals for Antonio, the candle for Abuela, a chameleon for Carmelo, a weight for Luisa, goodies is what they said for Julieta, a music note for Dolores, and Abuelo is a butterfly. Those are Oruguitas, That's my diginos for today.
Thank you, Tong, for that. We'll move on to the animation angle. And let I start my animation angle today saying, and this is not to me backtrack shitting on Raya at all, but if you recall, I might have said at the beginning of Raya where I was like, yeah, the animation doesn't feel as good at the beginning when they were kids. And then I was like, yeah, it gets better when they're adults. And I thought I was kind of losing my mind a little. And me and Brad were both on the same page with that, where it was like, okay. After watching the first, like, I don't know, two musical numbers in this, we turned to each other. And it's weird because we paused it and we were like, okay, but this is actually leaps and bounds beyond Raya. Like, and it's not, again, I don't want to like come down on that movie too hard, but when we were watching it, we both were like, why does this feel like it's not as like Disney impressive? Like, I feel like in this in Dummies, now that we're caught up and we're on the 60th episode, I used the term a lot on the early episodes of them flailing their dick around and it just feels like they haven't done that in a while. And I feel like on Raya we were both kind of like, this doesn't feel like Disney quality, and this movie I feel like showed us again why Disney is known as like such a great animation studio, because you watch this and you're like, oh, this is fucking insane. And I didn't get that vibe from Raya. I didn't watch Raya and was like, oh, this is fucking insane, which I expected to get. And I didn't. This movie made me be like, oh yeah, you guys are crazy. Like the animation in this is better. And the emotions and the range of emotions, and even just like talking about how the thought going into each character and how they dance differently, they act differently, it like really pays off. And like we talked on the that sad song there, Dose whatever.
I
should. You get dose whatever.
I know. Abuela, though, when Abuela like is crying because he's dying off screen, like that isn't like, I don't know who animated that. I doubt you're listening to Disney Dummies, but if you are, like that is insane. It's insanely good. It's just like I just can't like imagine animating that so well.
Someone referenced someone, whatever animator did that, reference a real person going through real grief in a moment in time and just did that. And
or it's... you were trying to act it out yourself, which is also traumatizing. Either watching somebody or like trying to figure it out yourself, how your face and that's what I mean. Like, you like just acting in general is crazy to like kind of like tap into that kind of emotion, and to be able to do that in this medium is crazy. And so I just gotta say right off the bat that this movie made me excited almost about Disney again, because I was definitely feeling that, like, I don't like, we were getting a lot of sequels and it was good and it was fine, but then this movie I was like, oh yeah, like, you're really like, I don't know, it really reboosted that kind of feeling.
Animation wise,
for me,
for sure.
Animation wise, yeah, excitement. Yeah. Definitely hype. The only other thing, yes, we already kind of talked embroidery, which I think is nuts in this movie. Like, the like fabric on them is crazy.
Mirabel's purse that she carries around, which is like completely like, dude, knitted. It's like, what are you
crochet?
Yeah, and the animation on all of Mirabel is just, it's insanely
facial reactions are completely like, oh my god, they're insane.
It's so good. And then also this movie, so the one that I like just learned about researching today was that Encanto was the first Disney movie to have choreographers involved in the development start to finish, but this directly affected animation in the sense that animation kind of hired, I guess, this African-American choreographer, what was his name, Jamal Sims, who then immediately hired a Colombian-American dancer, Kai Martinez, as the film's animation reference consultant. And so not only did the animation department, from what I've gathered here, get reference videos and stuff of all these dances, but they actually worked together and got feedback from the choreographers on the animated scenes, which is crazy cool to me. Because usually you're just like working off the reference, but for the like dancers to actually be like, ooh, like, you animated it this way, but it should like be like that. That's like so cool to me. And I was saying, like, each of the characters kind of has different dance styles as well, and apparently Luisa's is more reggaeton, which I don't know, I'm not familiar with that dance style, whereas Mirabel is more of a Cali salsa. So yeah. I think that's super fucking dope.
That is so cool,
right? Oh, that's right.
So cool. Even the colors in this movie are just so vibrant. It's hard not, like, at least for me, it's hard not to like it, because it's just such overwhelming positivity as well. Like, it's good.
And I tell you what, I didn't mind the birds.
You didn't mind the birds?
Speaking of colors, this brings me a weird segue into our 5-star, 1-star.
Wow. 5-star, 1-star for a very recent movie. Here we go.
Are you trying to do like gold star or?
No. I'm actually going to start with the bad this time, just because we were talking about the colors. Oh, okay. I found it actually very hard for this movie to do this segment because I've condensed some, but like, I find now sifting through the 1-stars and the 5-stars,
it's no
everyone's
fun.
Writing fucking paragraph after paragraph. And like, I'm like, legitimate. Oh my god, guys. Yeah. Like,
it's our fault for not coming with this like until like episode, what was the movie, it was Home on the Range or whatever.
So this was the thing.
Yeah,
the longer it's been since a movie has come out, the better the reviews become. Because they just sort of descend into chaos, like they have nothing to do with the movie anymore. Like after about the 10-year mark. But as we've caught up with the movies, the reviews become like actual reviews, and you're sort of like, this isn't what I want.
It's too much. It's
garbage.
So I'm going to speed read the first one just because I think there was a lot of... I'll speed read the first one. The other two are quick, so I can read them normally. But this first one was a 1-star one, but they just talk about so many things that I will just like blast through it. But they even did point form, so it's okay. So get ready for this 1-star. Boxed in movie, 95% of the film involves the house. Small note, chances are you're going to find it boring 30 minutes in or halfway through.
That's when surface pressure hits. You're lying.
Yeah. Falsified trailer that felt like an adventure movie. Here's where this I get this person. Movie. If you're listening, I forget what their username was, but you can go fuck yourself. this person says,
too many female characters.
Oh, fuck you. Yeah. Whoever said that.
I know. Male characters rarely appear, and when they do, it's to comfort their loved ones. Okay. What? Like, that's a bad thing.
What? Okay.
What?
Being supportive is being... Oh, I hate that.
Yeah, no,
I hate
this that. Person sucks. This person sucks. A Disney version of a soap opera / musical hybrid drama. Kids... Oh, but this is why I was thinking of this. Because it was like, kids will love the colors. This movie... All of this movie has to offer is colors.
As if soap opera / musical is an established genre that we are constantly being bombarded with.
I'm going to keep powering through these things. Yeah. Plot is hard to understand and follow for kids. Adults won't really understand the plot either, unless maybe they understood the subtle dialogue between Mirabelle and Bruno, as well as the grandmother, Elma, and Bruno, who foretold the future of the house. And it's like, dude, just because you're stupid?
I will say... There was a lot when we watched it this time. I was like, oh, I don't remember. Like, I think maybe you need two watches to get the plot of the movie, but you definitely don't need two watches to get the themes of the movie.
No.
Yeah. Honestly, this person just has all these bogus opinions that I'm like, this is the worst review I've ever read. Yeah. I think I'm done with this one. I was going to read a few more points, but I'm like, you don't even deserve my time. Yeah.
Burn it.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm gonna burn it. I guess their last, once they get out of their point forms, they were like, Encanto will be annoying to the boys, it'll be loved by the girls, and adults will find it confusing and boring.
I'm a boy. I love it.
Yeah. Also, this is like just feeding
what
into
a shitty
the...
review.
What a shitty review.
I think it's such a classic trope that like review. Movies about boys, both girls and boys will enjoy, but movies about girls, only girls will enjoy.
Yeah, yeah. So whoever wrote that,
go fuck yourself. Yeah. Also, I've never thought about this movie in a boy-girl stance.
No,
ever. Like it's such a family movie. It's about family.
Yeah.
Yeah, very dumb. So the other one star, I don't know why I even highlighted. I actually rate this a 6 out of 10 because I feel like they could have done so much more. Like when I see the trailer, I expect an adventure, but instead, Mirabelle just goes into Bruno's room. I think it's funny because she does just go into Bruno's room, and it's also funny that they gave it one star, but they're like, it's a 6 out of 10, which to me is like more than
stars.
A one.
Yeah, that's
3 stars out of 5.
Yeah,
that's a one star. Not
everyone learned fractions.
Yeah, and this one was from a 5 star. I only took the first paragraph because they went on to write a shit ton more. So take it with a grain of salt. But 5 stars. This movie changed my life. Its cultivating plot lines and amazing acting skill put me in tears. Before watching, I was a homeless man living in the streets. After seeing this film, I became a billionaire. I have a wife and 3 kids, a 4-story house, and a collection of Lamborghinis. I would highly recommend this film to anyone of all ages, religion, gender, and race.
I question their use of the word cultivating. Yeah. I don't think that's what they meant.
I really want to know, like, it sounds fake, but obviously,
yeah.
I would love to know how this movie changed their life
you
so they
can
find
that review approximately 5% of all products on the internet.
How did that happen? Watching
Encanto, I'm pretty sure, to be fair, in their following 5 paragraphs, they went on to be like, no, but seriously.
Boo.
I don't know. But yeah.
Fair.
So that's 5 star, 1 star.
That's good.
Yeah. I love it. But that's kind of it for this episode. I mean, it's been a long one.
Well, hot takes.
Oh my God. Yes. I didn't have that written down. Sorry.
Do you need your host status revoked?
No. You're right. I don't know how I could have forgotten, but here we are.
I don't want to say I'm disappointed. But I'm close.
You can't be like, it's a Ben episode. It's fine.
No, it's we're all friends here.
Well, we're here. And I mean, here's the sequence I forgot about, folks. Hot takes.
Hot takes. Brought to you by
Bruno's bucket hat.
There we go.
I was going to say.
Literally a bucket hat.
Oh, I was going to say the candle.
Our Mama Julieta's arepas fresh from the oven.
The candle fucks.
I was wondering if the candle fucked. Okay.
Ouch.
Candle fucks.
Tone, take us away on these hot takes.
Hot take is, I already said this, but I actually think this movie is better when you have the subtitles on. I'm just going to go ahead and say that. That's my hot take.
All right.
And that's only because, like I said, that there's so many good lyrics that are happening that it actually very much helps
to
know what they're saying. Because remember what you were saying, in, we don't talk about Bruno, like Felix, what he says, like, da-da-da-da, go on.
Like, it's hard to me that go on.
Like, you wouldn't ever understand what he's talking about unless you had the lyrics in front of you. So, like, yes, subtitles, better for Encanto.
Me? Biggest regret of our wedding is that we didn't play any songs from Encanto on the dance floor.
Yeah. It's true. But there's a lot of songs that weren't played at our wedding. We didn't get Mulan at our wedding.
Songs. There's too many good songs.
We tried, man.
We didn't even get Bugsnax on our wedding.
Yeah, I requested it.
We got Tangled.
Yeah.
I don't have any hot takes because I forgot this segment existed.
Oh. Sam, it's been 60 episodes. Literally 60 episodes.
And I've never been very good at it.
I would say one third of the episodes of 60, you've forgotten about hot takes. That's okay, because Laura forgets about the Who Fuck segment 90% of the time.
This is accurate.
I always remember that segment.
Yeah, I know. It shows our priorities in this group. Okay, I'll rapid fire some. How many do you have, Laura?
I have like four more.
Okay, we can go back and forth.
Oh my god, you guys have so many. Yeah, I back and forth. Do it's your always thing. Like
last minute. They're very lukewarm. The power to have super hearing sounds awful. Dolores's power seems like a curse. She
I wonder if she can turn it
she
off.
She handles it very well, I will say. She never seems like she's in pain because of her power. Also, we never mentioned betrothed to another.
So good.
I remember that single lyric was like trending on Twitter and TikTok for a while.
That was before I was on Twitter.
Here's a hot question. You know the bit where the house appears out of nowhere and Abuela is there, but there's also like an entire village of other people with her? Why did she get the house? There were so many rooms and she got the whole house.
She had the candle,
herself.
Though. She had the candle.
She, I guess, but like.
What a crappy candle.
You think young Casita was a dick? Like, young Casita just kicked everyone out.
It could have been that Casita kicked everyone else out to make it clear that it was Abuela's house.
Yeah.
Abuela's family's house.
Speaking of Abuela, my other hot take was that she really should have got her own song. Why didn't she get her own song? Mm-hmm. She is actually one of the main...
She got The Miracle Is You.
Sort of. Like, she sings a verse in that. Mm-hmm. But one of my did you knows was that the Abuela actress was also in The Heights as well as the Abuela in that movie.
Well, the singing voice.
Singing Abuela.
But yeah. The acting voice of Abuela was different from
But
Abuela
I was talking
Colombia.
About the singing voice.
Yeah,
okay. I feel like with
it
a voice
counts.
Like that.
Still counts.
So if you get this like really, really great singer, give her more. Give her more.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Peppa is all of us during the pandemic. Just emotional volatility, can't keep it together and feels like creating the entire mood of everyone around us because we can't handle our emotions because we don't know where we're going.
It's so interesting diving into these characters one by one and seeing their insecurities. Cause like, if you think about Peppa up until the very end of the movie where it's like, she's having hail. And it's so interesting to be like, she's always expected to have clear skies. Right. So anytime she's like, oh, you have a gray cloud, try to be happy. Yeah. Like, think about that mental health state that you'd be in to just constantly try to push away your problems just to have.
I feel like it's a very similar one to Flower Girl, though. Isabella.
Yeah.
I feel like they're both like, you got to be perfect. You got to be happy. You got to be like those two are similar in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. This isn't a hot take, but I wrote it down. And I think I mentioned it before, like the essay that I was watching was like, how the villain of this movie is no person. Like, that's what's cool about this movie is there's no real villain. It's a metaphor villain. And the villain is the resistance to change and how everybody is very scared to move on because of the matriarch in the family who's also afraid to move on because of what she's been through and how she lost the love of her life. Yeah. And the only thing she has in this world is her family. So to be able to keep it safe, she does things that are very extreme. So I think
makes
that's
it a good kids movie too. The fact that there's movie. No like explicit villain.
I agree. I think like in a movie, like I actually compare this movie to Zootopia in a way, not give me a second here, is that Zootopia tries to tell you about a very heavy topic in the form of a movie. And it's very heavy handed the way they talk about racism and stuff like that, which I think works, but is also like hard to keep watching in a way, where Encanto talks about these like just
it's so much more complex
universal feelings that anybody can have. And I think it hits harder with the heart to see what's happening in Encanto over Zootopia.
I think it's subtlety as well. Like you were saying, Zootopia is so hard-handed with it.
Oh, yeah.
That it's like a little bit like eye-rolly, whereas this movie is much more digestible. And you're like, I get it. It's just, it's like...
Yeah, definitely. Nicer. Zootopia is like, we don't say the word cute for bunnies. Okay.
Don't you dare.
Okay, Zootopia.
Do you know what a microaggression is? hot question for the crew. Which family member are you?
Oh, great question.
I'm probably Peppa.
I think I'm a Luisa with a Bruno Moon and an Isabella Rising.
Oh, what? Jeez. Laura, you know me better than anyone. What would you? I don't fit. I don't fit in the family.
No. It's actually very obvious which one you are.
What?
Julieta.
The mother?
Yeah. What's her gift?
The healer.
The healing through food?
Yeah.
Oh, you think I heal people through food?
Yeah, absolutely. Very interesting. You heal me through food.
Okay. All right, Sam. I'll heal you through food. I guess I've healed you before through food, through dumplings. Exactly. Maybe ramen next time.
That sounds right.
In my heart of hearts, I feel very Louisa. Mm-hmm. I think just like the idea that I have to keep going. Like I can't. I'm not sat. This does feel like therapy, by the way.
The way I'm right? That. It does.
This is things that I literally would tell my therapist.
Do you want to read it?
What? I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can't be of service. Honestly, yes. The entire theme of that move or that song really hits with me, just to like think of myself as always, like, you know, inferior or whatever it is. And I have to continually prove myself. Otherwise, I'm done for, right? So I really resonate with that.
I think like dealing with, this is not who I am, but it's like, I don't know, like having a grandparent, like my grandma was Latvian and like got shipped off during the war and had a very terrible time as a teenager, like during World War II. And I feel like watching stories like this, and it's like she would be the grandmother, I guess, you know, and it's just like, nobody knows how to deal with that amount. Like, it's such a like heavy, high amount of trauma that it's like, how do you, nobody's like knows what to, everyone handles it differently. Every like from the people that bear it to the like next to the next. And it's just like such a like load. It's such a load that nobody knows what the fuck to do with.
No, like, no, there's no right answers.
No.
Do you have more hot takes, Laura?
I have two more. You might remember me teasing my note that said hot takes that I wrote on my viewing of the movie.
Let's go.
And underneath the words hot takes, I actually didn't write anything because I forgot to take notes, but I remember what my hot take was. You're going to be shocked because this is the girl who pretty much anytime we watch a non-musical movie, I'm like, it wasn't that great. And when we watched Encanto, the note that I mentally took was, this didn't need to be a musical.
What?
That is insane coming from you, but also a take that I read from like an old director I had who was like, oh, I would have liked this movie more if it wasn't a musical.
That's fucking crazy. This entire movie is a musical.
So, I know.
Addendum to that initial hot take is that to a certain extent, I stand by that hot take, but the follow up is that thank God it was, because so many songs in this movie slap.
This whole movie is ingrained in music, not even just in the musical fashion, but how everyone moves.
Like what they did in terms of the story, they could have done really well without needing music to do it. Mm. It would have been a different movie, but I think like it could have been done in a really incredible way.
Yeah.
That being said, like that's a whole other movie altogether. And I think that this is a great movie.
Of course.
And again, I am very glad that.
I do agree. I think it was a weird, like, I don't want to even say weird. It's like an interesting choice for music, and I'm glad for the music we got out of it, because it all works and they made it work and it is strong, a lot of it. But I do think this movie could be done as not a musical. Like, it could be done. It would be really heavy. I think the music lightens the mood a lot.
I disagree.
It makes it like digestible potentially, I guess.
Yeah. The playfulness of the entire, like, the mood of the movie is definitely dictated by how the music kind of like dictates how, like, how characters move and how they act towards each other and stuff like that.
Zootopia didn't have music.
Yeah, but it's so different. Like, it doesn't need, like, if dudes
that was a mystery too. That's, this was a
Shakira erasure, Sam.
Yeah.
Try everything, Sam.
Yeah. Raya, for example, does not need to be a musical, right? Like, I feel
maybe
like
maybe it should have been.
I just don't think so. You should have said that hot take during Raya.
That's okay. You can come in with hot takes 2 weeks later. That's okay.
Yeah, that's how I roll. I need to take my time. Don't judge me. I'm gonna write a song about it.
Section even exists, then she'll come up with it.
Guys, I'm gonna have a whole spin-off episode that's just like Sam's hot takes for 60 Disney movies, and it's just me rapid fire hot take.
Continue, Laura. Last
I only
one.
Have one hot take. Do you have any left?
No, I have
okay,
zero.
Okay, this is my last hot take on the 60th Disney Dummies episode. I just thought it was so important to take a moment to say to my friends, Sam and Tang, the miracle is you.
Stop it, Laura!
Thank you. First of all, I actually had the hot take in my phone that I forgot to read, but I wrote something exactly the same, which I was just like, guys.
You didn't read it.
I didn't read it. I forgot. After this entire journey, 2.5 years of doing Disney movies together, little did I know the Encanto was all of us.
Oh, like, something my God. Like,
truly, though, what an honor and what a pleasure it's been to just...
And dare I say a privilege.
To do all
guys,
of
guys, I'm so sad.
It is interesting.
Disney Dummies never ends. Disney Dummies lives on in all of us, in all of you listeners, and also in your ears as more Disney movies come out and we create subsequent episodes.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk about the logistics later about that, but we'll let Sam continue before we talk about the other stuff.
Well, now I'm just sad. Okay, listeners
at
home.
No, you should be happy.
I'm not sad.
Look what we accomplished.
Look at me. I'm making sunshine out of rain clouds. How? Like a true Peppa.
Let's talk about how, like, we started Disney Dummies, what, Moana era?
when Moana was coming out? No,
Moana was out already.
Moana was out. Yeah. It was like, Raya was the first movie to come
out.
Dude,
we were past Frozen 2.
Yeah.
That is... Yeah, absolutely, Matt. Like, think about that,
guys.
Like,
I think Raya was the first to come out.
How many bad movies we've seen? Like, I'm thinking about all of we always shit on them, but think about all those, like, short film things that we saw, like Make Mine Music, Melody
but
Time,
Fancy Free.
It's true. So we're also
that one bear.
Oh my God. So we're at an interesting spot now too, which might be a Disney Dummy first. Did we have one where none of us had seen it yet?
Yeah, there was one. I forget.
Oh, there was one.
Black Cauldron being one. There were a few of them.
There was a few of them. Yeah.
Okay. There was a few, but like the next movie, like we're all gonna just be going into as fresh little babies.
Also,
like,
I will say right now for the people at home, because Sam's going to be technically doing the summary for the new one. Like, I don't know how she's going
to
do it.
Yeah, I'm going to have to, like, be memorizing the movie.
She'll have to, like, see it twice in theaters and write down notes in the theater. I don't know. I don't know how
to say it. I might have to go see it twice. First, to just, like, watch and enjoy like a normal person. And second, to just go fucking make notes for. That might be my
Sit
burden,
in the back row,
I think.
Put your phone on low light.
Yeah, I think I might have to do that, and or like pay to rent it at home so I could do that.
Yeah.
If that's still like a thing I can do.
Can't, probably not. Disney
no?
wants their money.
Oh,
Disney
man,
wants their
okay.
money.
Maybe,
guys,
like,
listeners at home, I live beside a theater. Yeah. I'll figure it out.
We'll figure it out.
But now we can like talk because our nostalgia segment is
it's
not
dead.
Gonna really exist
R.I.P.
anymore.
Hey, pour one out for the nostalgia segment.
Well,
we're
maybe
done.
It's we've been talking about it for episodes upon episodes. I think the real plan is that we will release the vacation episode of Disney Dummies, which we recorded months and months and months ago when we all went to Disney World.
Oh, remember Disney World?
And had a debrief and talked about the
Got
best
COVID.
Things about Disney, all those things. I'll also release the top five Disney films also on the Disney Dummies podcast feed as well as rank top five lists, stuff that don't matter. And then after that, we will absolutely be covering every new Disney theatrical release that comes out in this feed. But I do think at some point, maybe immediately, we haven't talked about it yet, we will actually do Pixar Pals as well.
Yeah.
Into this feed. Disney Dummies and Pixar Pals are the exact same. You're going to find it wherever you find your Disney Dummies podcast.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out.
We will figure it out. But all that to say is for the new Disney movies, we don't really need to have nostalgia. So, yeah. I mean, I guess, I guess we still can talk about if we're excited or not about it in the next episode. I'll leave it since this one's long enough and we're not going to get into it now. But the next movie that you'll hear from us after all those other things that Tung just said will be Strange Worlds.
Strange Worlds. That's so interesting. Yeah.
And let's not close the door on Disney Homies or Disney Shorties or Dummies Live, where we cover the live action.
We're not doing that.
You know what? We might run up content one day.
Oh my God. Listeners at home, tell us what you want.
Yeah. I'll tell you one thing. I will veto Disney, like, straight to animated TV show.
Disney Homies.
Is that Disney
Homies? Dude, those might be better than the fucking live action.
Direct to home release is Disney Homies. I think we should. I think that's an avenue we should.
I do not want to watch Pocahontas.
Oh my god!
Yeah, but
no, nobody does.
Do you want to watch the Return of Jafar?
Yes, that's actually a good one.
But maybe we just like put movies in a hat that we really want to do.
We could do that. Honestly, that would be fun. Mm-hmm. But Pixar Pals, I will say, will definitely happen. Right. And can I confirm that?
Probably. Oh, I would be down with that.
And that's a way for us to bring back nostalgia. Like, we basically reset the clock, but it's a much shorter.
I believe it's pronounced nostalgia, Tung.
Nostalgia. There's way less Pixar films than there are Disney theatrical films. I mean, there's still like 26, 28. I don't know.
We'd have, it would definitely prolong our significance on this podcast. And then we'll catch up with that. And then we'll do DreamWorks dunces. And, you know, we'll just keep it going from there.
I don't know. I don't know if we can sign off on DreamWorks or Sony, though.
Hey, listen, we're not there yet.
We're not there. Yeah.
The point is, the Disney Dummies, we love you guys for listening to as many episodes as you have.
You've listened to them all, right?
You've listened to them all, front to back. Watch every single thing with us. But we like doing this. We're going to keep doing it. It's not going anywhere.
Yeah, and we're making so much money.
Guys, we're so rich.
We've got Lamborghinis.
Honestly, the Encanto has been all of the money
we've made. We have
some this podcast changed my life. It's cultivating plot lines. Before watching, I was a homeless man living.
Things have really taken a turn. Taken a turn. To be clear, we make no money.
Negative money.
This costs us money to do, but we do it.
I'm losing money right now.
Honestly, though, this podcast is very popular. So I will say, surprisingly, people do
literally dozens of fans.
No, so, more than that. Stop selling a short.
Dozens.
Hundreds. I will say
hundreds.
Well, we love you, and that's really exciting, and that's a really heartwarming note, I think, to end off on, that you guys want to join us on all these Disney miracles, because that's what we all are. We're all a miracle.
So email us at miracles@podcavern.com
and tell us, what's your miracle?
Please do, and join us next time on, I guess, maybe the very special episode of our Disney trip. And we will see you in Disney World. Na, na, na.